Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We'll start with the second technical session on GST audit focus areas from supply perspective. Aita. To handle this session, we have an eminent and very senior speaker, CA TR Rajesh Kumar. May I request our chairman, Ravindra S. Kore, to escort the speaker onto the dais and welcome with bouquet. I take this opportunity to give a brief introduction of CA Rajesh Kumar. He is a BCom, LLB, FCA and DSA. He is one of the core partner of Hiragangi and Associates. He has created litigation wing in the firm and driving the same since last 15 years. He has conceptualized implication under indirect taxation on practical aspects of trade and industry and assisting them in addressing their concerns in these subjects. He has written to professional and trade community by writing articles on different indirect taxes for various professional and trade journals. He has jointly authored more than 15 books on service tax, KVAT and GST. He is a regular faculty on indirect taxes for the seminars and certificate course organized by the ICAI. He is a visiting faculty for different colleges also. He is also invited by NACN and the tax departments of both center and state for training their officers. With this brief introduction, I present before you CA Rajesh Kumar TR. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank Bangalore branch for giving me this wonderful opportunity for being here. And the topic which is given to me is a mixture of law and practice. In the GST law, as I am seeing, it is becoming difficult to balance the both. Especially if we go and sit in any seminar and hear any of the speakers, we get disturbed. Why do we get disturbed? Do we get disturbed first of all? Yes or no? Okay. Why do we get disturbed? No, I think many of our understanding would have been taken for task. What we would have been thinking, they may give a totally different perspective, different view. But if we go back to our offices and try to adapt that in our routine working, the client says, sir, what is this? How can you expect all these things to be done by us? So that is where I said it is becoming a difficult to balance both. In fact, today the date is 29th of February, the leap year, the extra day. GST is also getting leap by extending due dates, 17, 18. We are still, some of us are still trying to close those audit reports. Now the topic which is given to me, I need to speak about the supply, but in the perspective of a GST audit. Now, Before I go into my topic, first of all, I was not clear as to what is the role of a chartered accountant in this audit, because I have not signed anything yet. My other partners will sign, but I don't sign. So effectively, why I am asking this question, if we see this, what is the actual scope of the GST audit? We are getting a different version from different sources. Is it merely a reconciliation statement? That means, here is this figure, here is this figure, there's a difference. Or should we see, okay, it is not merely putting a figure from here to here, we should see whether this figure which we are putting here, is it complete in all respect? Whether all the transactions have been appropriately recorded in the books of accounts, or it is sufficient we merely take a figures from the financial audited financial statement and say already it is audited, if it is audited, and take it and put it. We need not go into the completeness aspect of it. Is that what is our scope? Okay, one is just merely putting the figure. No, that is not sufficient. We need to see also whether something is missed out. We go one step ahead and try to ensure that nothing is missed out. Okay, does it stop there? Or should we see what the figures which have been put or the value which have been put, is it correct or not? The taxable values or the tax rate for that matter. Are we supposed to go one more step ahead and try to do that? Okay, that is fine. Further, one more step going ahead, the documentation and procedure which should have been followed as per the provisions of the law, including rules, regulations, are we supposed to look into that and also comment upon? You may hear different versions. Some of them may confine only to the first, some of them 1 plus 2, some of them 1 plus 2 plus 3, some of them may be 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. So I think it is as per the circular, or sorry, press note rather, why the board says, no, you need not do too many things. First complete. Mylar says, first complete and give it off and go. Because people are not filing. In fact, all those optional thing which came in November 19, 1.5 months before, I was sitting with a commissioner who is reasonably recognized by the government. So I was just discussing in general. He asked, why the returns or the audit, 9Cs are not getting filed? I said, sir, we can't file it, sir. What are you talking? You're auditor, no? You will audit. Sir, I will give you, assume that you are auditor, you fill up these particular forms and show me whether we can fit up. Oh, is that the difficulty, is it? Okay, let me talk to the concerned persons. So what will, sir, give an option. If somebody wants to fill it up, let them fill it up. So I think like this, now, is it better to take an option or better not to take an option? As an auditor, you are now in a position, you have to take a decision whether you have to opt for a consolidated figure disclosure or give a details, as much details as is being asked in the original form. Now, if you say, no, we'll put one consolidated figure, later on some inquiry comes. If there is any error, some gross tax liability coming, which is going to affect the continuity of the business itself, your going concern is getting affected. Being an auditor, can we ignore any factor which is going to affect a going concern itself, is a primary thing. Now, basically you would have said a trading entity, who had filed the returns after March 19 for the first year. Now, margin is 10% for the trading entity. Imagine a situation, the return for the entire 17-18 is filed only after 31st of March 2019. Now we have whatever, certified 9C and issued. Now we have started getting a love letters from the department saying, any returns filed after the cutoff date, the entire credit itself is ineligible. Now, there is one equity or a justice or reasonability, other is a law. Somebody who reads the provision of 16.4 strictly, he may clearly come to a conclusion what the department is saying is right. But we have not quantified, we have not said so in our report, we have said eligible. Then the entire credit, if it gets disallowed, the turnover into 90% into 18% is the impact of plus interest. The capital will get eroded fully. So I am just telling why, what is the role of a chartered accountant or a cost accountant who is going to do an audit? Does it stop merely by a reconciliation if somebody asks? In the future, obviously, Banu would have discussed or any other advocate, these notices are going to get quashed. But till then, if some recovery happens, some bank attachment happens, then various issues come, and if the question is raised on to the chartered accountant, do we have a sufficient documentation to establish that what we have done was appropriate? Or if you say, no, there's a press release over here which says we need to only do this thing, we need not go beyond, so therefore you need not blame us. So these are certain things which need to be. The next point which I put is whether the auditor is a parliament or a Supreme Court. Why am I asking this question? Who knows GST law today? Everybody knows, nobody knows. There used to be, when we were reading economics, they say, when three economists join, there is a four views. Here in GST, two people, not only experts, I'm not talking, two people meets, there will be five opinions on the same issue. So that being a case, how can you say that this is what the assessee is supposed to do? This is what he is liable to pay. This is what is required to pay and report to that. He has not paid so and so amount. How can we categorically conclude and put him into the terms behind the jail? Are we empowered to do it? Are we given authority to assess the tax? As an auditor, can we be an assessing officer? In my view, clearly no. Yes, we have to give a reconciliation statement to be, to the extent that it has to be, there is no misstatement of the facts, but if there is a differing view, in my understanding, we need not say that assessee should do this. It is only a recommendation, not a compulsion upon the assessees. Because many of the places I have heard, unless you pay, I will not file 9C, I will not sign 9C. It is a prerogative of the assessee to take it or not take it. Now, later on, if a chartered accountant has done an audit of a records under the GST law, have given the report 9C. Later on, tax authorities after 3 years or 4 years comes and does the investigation. And in the process of which they found that, you know, there's some invoices were dummy, the credit was not valid taken, no payments were made, but still the credits were taken, so many points, and they'll raise a notice. Can they make even an auditor a party to that particular notice? In my understanding, it cannot be that. But provided as a auditor, we have kept sufficient working paper as to our reporting or the whatever the figures which we would have disclosed. And at the same time, please keep this press release in your working papers clearly. In the engagement letter, management representation letter, all those things. But it cannot be such that, which is prima facie visible, you cannot say, no, I did not see it. So it cannot go to such an extent that you can ignore certain transactions, certain aspects, which could have been found out clearly on the prima facie looking at any particular transaction. With this background, from the perspective of the audit, if considering the supply as a major item in this 9C reporting, it can be of three different aspects. One, the process of your verification of supplies, the concepts which needs to be understood, and the reporting part. Processes, concepts, and reporting. Now, if I go into the process, I have tried to put in a particular fashion so that essentially everything gets covered, and this is, you can call it a sort of a checklist or a methodology or whatever it is, but this will try to address almost all issues which can crop up. First of all, the major challenge come a particular transaction, is it supply or not? We'll come to that a little later. Now, we assume every transaction which has happened is a supply. That is a presumption with which you need to proceed. In that presumption, there are supplies which gets recorded in the books of accounts. There are supplies which doesn't get recorded in the books of accounts. I am not talking about evasion or avoiding the transaction to be recorded. As a transaction per se itself, it does not get recorded in the books. A transaction between related parties. So we need to first identify a transactions which do not get recorded in the books of accounts at all, and make a list of possible such transactions, so that you need to see whether this transaction, that list cannot be an exhaustive thing. Every time you go, the things may get added, some things may get added. But it is a must that we need to prepare one list of a possible transaction which doesn't get recorded in the books of accounts. Now, among the transactions which gets recorded in the books, certain of them will get recorded as a revenue, certain of the transactions do not get accounted as a revenue. Simple example is sale of fixed assets. Sale of fixed assets is a capital transaction. So it need not be there in your income and expenditure or profit and loss account to take only sales and compare that particular transactions of a GST. So we need to see which are all the transactions which are not of a revenue nature, which doesn't get recorded as a revenue but gets recorded somewhere else in the books of accounts. Now, okay, some of them gets accounted as revenue, but the value what we record under the in the financial records are different from the value which is supposed to be considered for the purpose of value under the GST law. Non-monetary consideration received from a recipient. Do we get it so easily from the books of accounts? May not be. So these are all the transactions before we checking the records, we need to understand, considering the nature of business, the type of transaction at the master level, master or the agreement level, then get into verification. We cannot do this after going there while checking the documentation or the transactions. This is something which we need to be careful upon. There may be certain transaction which recorded as a revenue, but gets recorded with a timing difference. In a financial transaction, a sale transaction gets recorded when the sales happens. In the GST, the time of supply is different, so consequently you would record at that time. Similarly, for a construction sector, the revenue recognition policy may be different than the time of supply provisions under the GST law. So what are all the possible differences which is going to come as to the timing differences should be first marked, considering the nature of businesses, and then according to that we need to assess what checks need to be done, what quantification of the values to be arrived at. If we do not have this classification, we may get lost in the process of merely looking into here and there, and finally we may end up finally signing off because the time is lapsing. Now the next is, the supply would have been there, the value recorded, but there may be a subsequent adjustments through a credit note or debit note, where in the financial books it may be affected in the same transactions, or it may be affected in a different place in a different manner. So whether any such transactions do exist, and if it exists, how it's impact in the financials vis-a-vis how it's going to impact the GST supplies, value of supplies, requires to be linked out. These are all from the outward supply perspective. Coming into the aspect of reverse charge mechanism, which is also treated as a taxable turnover for the purpose of GST in one of those tables, which is not then the revenue side of it. We only concentrate majorly the revenue side. We may tend to lose out if we are not putting this as a part of the checklist or the whatever the audit plan, to check the expenditure side or the outgo side. Again, the same thing as to record it in the books, need not record in the books also will be there. So the related party transactions, etc., and may have to give an effect to. Now this is one level of merely identifying the possible areas with how to proceed further. The next challenge comes in if it is a multiple registration, segregating the turnover at a registration level, validation of that segregation. Then some common revenues where multiple branches are involved but revenue is generated, how it is to be recorded or accounted, whether there is a separate segregation made for the GST purpose or not. If it is not, whether there is any cross charge happening to that, to give effect to that. To my understanding, majority of the cases this cross charge would have not at all been looked into or would have missed out, and invariably there may be an issue. Majority of the cases it may be a revenue neutral situation, because anyhow the one branch charging, the other branch would have taken an input tax. However, if there is any exempted supplier from the other place where something is received, then always there can be a question that there is a loss of revenue to the exchequer and there is a clear by non-compliance to that extent, and there is a liability which may come up at a future date. Why I try to put this broad classification is, now when you actually trying to get into each classification or each identification of this, you will be posed with lot of questions as to legal provisions. Now, which are all the transactions which doesn't get recorded in the books of accounts? As I told, which are all the provisions relevant? What is the valuation for it? I don't receive the money. What is the time of supply? It takes lot of aspects to document this for each of the transactions, but nevertheless, it is must. So, my humble suggestion would be that as a part of an auditor, please look at, at least for 18-19, you have a documentation to establish that you have done this type of exercise to verify, and if something still missed, it can be there, but at least majority things gets covered once you take up this approach. Now, having identified this is the turnover of overall recorded, not recorded, total supplies. Now, it requires to identify whether supply or not supply. Examples I have put later. I will discuss about the issues later. But the point is whether a particular transaction is a supply or not. An individual proprietorship business . There is a shortage of funds in the business. He goes home, opens the locker, he takes some jewelry of his personal thing and sells it to generate fund for the business. He's a registered person. Is it supply or not supply? No, I don't want to answer. I'm just telling, some of you may say, no, no, sir, it cannot be supply. Some of you may say, no, no, sir, it may be supply. I respect each of your views. Because there's an argument for this as well, there's an argument for this as well. This is where the time has to tell which is correct. This is what I told in my first slide. Can we become a parliament? Can we become a tax authorities? Can we become a Supreme Court to decide what is right, what is wrong? Now, if an assessee has taken a stand, no, sir, it's my personal asset. It is, the sale is not happening in the course of my business. It is my personal asset sold as my personal capacity, but the money I'm bringing into the business. So it is not in the course of my business. So therefore, it cannot be taxed. That is the stand if he has taken. Can you say, no, 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 I am of the view that you should pay? Or you say, this is a stand taken and leave it at that. Or this is a stand taken, but I am of the view that there is a liability. One, accepting in the working note and leave it, not mentioning anything about it. Second, putting a note that these things have been done like this. Leave it at that. Third, the assessee has done like this, but this should be treated like this, is the third type. There's a possibility that many of us would have done each of these three, depending upon the adventurism which the auditor would like to take. Next is intrastate supply, interstate supply. though it may not be directly connected at the filling up the first table per se, but it is required for the future tables to ascertain. So better at the origin itself, we need to have this segregation. Then taxable, exempted, I am not getting to the rate of taxes. Again, there it is a major challenge. What is the classification? What is the applicable rate? Whether any exemption is there, whether partial exemption from the value, abatement is there. So those things, full rate of tax, abated rate of tax, this is a classification, sub-classification which needs to be done. Next, zero rated, that is taxable but supplied to SEZ or exported, therefore zero rated. Again, in zero rated, whether export on payment of tax or without payment of tax, clear segregation. So there are a lot of varieties of transactions in each of the turnover which requires a segregation to identify what is the actual tax payable on a particular, by a particular entity at a registration level. Now when I was talking about the thing, I also mentioned something about a completeness. A particular transaction is recorded, whether all the transactions have come into the 9, okay, where 9 is filed by the SSC, we have audited financial statement, should we stop at saying, okay, annual return and the financial statements, but there are, is any omission in 9 while they are filing, or should we go beyond that 9 and say, no, there is some omission which should have been there. If you have to do a completeness check, there may be different scenarios, that is manual record using computers. Today, I don't see anybody only writing a manual thing. So I have put it like, manual record keeping using computers. And the second is in a computerized environment. Each has its own challenges. As an auditor, experience with audit experience in the regular course, we have to apply all those methodology techniques to ascertain the completeness of a transaction being reported. Next is the correctness of a disclosure or a reporting. That is when we need to have a conceptual clarity. For the example which I mentioned about an individual. Now, next, somebody was asking me in the break, sir, I am having only exempted turnover, but I have availed a certain services which are liable to pay tax on a RCM basis. Am I required to take a registration? But he has not taken registration in that state. So, do we report? In fact, yesterday I was in meeting with one of the person, happens to be medical, that is a healthcare service, basically doctor, running an hospital. We are hospital, no sir, where is the tax on us? Okay. Sir, you have a medicine sales and all those things. No, we consume that. We don't sell it. Okay. Sir, do you have any sale of waste papers? Yes, we do have. In fact, I sold one car last year, in that year. Is it required to be registered? The turnover is less than 20 lakh. But he is of the clear understanding, no, he is not liable because the other turnovers are less than 20 lakh. And the understanding given by their auditor is also that there is no liability. I am telling now, I am not complaining or blaming whether the conceptual understanding of the assessee should be there or a conceptual understanding of the auditor should be there. Now I am not talking only from the perspective of a GST audit, I'm also talking from the perspective of a regular financial auditor. Can we do a financial audit without understanding the impact of the GST? In this example, if there's a liability of, say, around 10 lakh or whatever is coming in, then can that, it's going to affect the financial status of a particular entity, can it be reported so that there's true and fair to the knowledge of the financial statement? And majority of the cases, it so happens that in a hospitals, especially the private hospital or the nursing homes, there may be a situation where there'll be a medical store as well. Medical store run by the entity or run by other entity. If it's run by other entity, whether the rent charged for that. Generally, the rent would have not been charged because it will be somebody related entities may be there. So this is what I was trying to say. A transaction which involves a supply which doesn't get recorded in the books of accounts, and as an auditor, we may not come to know so clearly that this is there, but we will know because we are the auditor for that entity of a medical store also. But how can we ignore that? So this is where I said that the conceptual understanding is a must. We go on taking each of the issue. I am not trying to say this is right, this is wrong, but at least examine it and take a stand and have a supporting documentation to the stand you take. It may be payable, not payable, but you need to take a stand. You need to be aware of it. You cannot ignore it and leave it. Then it becomes a negligence, a professional negligence. When I was talking about the concepts, I have listed a couple of them, then I would like to leave the floor open for you to raise any questions on the supply related concepts. I'm going to try to address those in the context of audit. I gave an example of supply or not. The gold chain being sold and capital being infused into the business. Deemed supply. I gave an example of office space. In deemed supply, any asset which is belonging to a business entity being used by a partner or a proprietor for personal use is also deemed supply. Please understand this, GST is what they have done is each transaction need not be a financially recorded transaction. A transaction happening, whether it is in the course of business and for a consideration. And if any related parties are between the branches, then even if there is no consideration, any movement happening, the reason being that related party, they ignore that you are related, and if you are not related, would I have given that whatever the value or the rental free of cost, obviously, no. So they want to capture that economic activity, whether it is recorded or not recorded. Essentially, GST wants the economic activity to be captured in their record purposes, so your actual turnover to be recorded would go up, or GDP is going to increase if we take this as a basis. Similarly, in case of branches located at different states, please understand the concept of GST is that each state is a separate territory, separate taxing territory, separate government. Though central is only a via media, but the basic thing is The state government is the government which is entitled for the revenue of that particular transactions happening in that particular territorial jurisdiction. As an entity, it may be not having any impact, but as a government, it does make a difference of that revenue if the credit is blocked or etc., etc. So therefore, they are trying to capture at that each economic activity transaction level happening in the taxable territory of the state, irrespective of the fact whether it is between the same entity or between a different entity. So if we keep this in mind, many of our issues as to ascertaining the turnover, we will not miss out. Now, the rate of tax is one of the challenge which any businessman face. Sir, my competitor is charging 12%. You are asking me to charge 18%. No, boss, ask your competitor to at least give me that entry in the notification which tells 12%. No, sir, he says, no, I'm sure. Our auditor has told. Similar issue happened in one of the goods. In fact, my colleague is sitting here. He was handling that case. The client said, this product is, we told, no, this is 12%. He said, no, sir, nobody in the market is charging 12%. Everybody is charging 5%. Now, what is, can you just get us one bill? Sir, here is a bill. Wrong classification. No, this product cannot fit in to this. This is because this is not edible. No, sir. Everybody is doing this. And margin is very, very, very thin, sir. So we have to do nothing, no choice. I said, okay, it's your risk. But we ask only one question. If it is chemically tested, whatever the product, can you establish that it is edible or not? If you can, then you go ahead. We don't agree on principle, but at least you can. Recently, we understand that all those people who are charging lesser rate were all visited by their good friends for an increased rate of tax, for the differential tax. Now, they are not collected from the customers. They have to pay out of their pocket. So there's a major challenges which do come. So why I'm saying is the classification of a goods based on the turnover, not only the goods within the goods which rate, whether the transaction is that of a supply of a goods or a supply of a service, because the rates may change. One such example is temples and other places where, you know, entry tickets with a barcode, etc., were asked to be printed. They give order for the printing of those tickets. The tickets gets printed and supplied. Is it supply of a goods or supply of service? Works contract. Now in the GST, works contract is only confined to immovable property. Okay? So is it supply of goods or supply of service? There's a rate, for it is said that any printing out of the content given by the recipient is treated as supply of service, and there is a rate for that. There's also rate of tax plus the printed materials, etc., in the goods schedule. So which of this is to be applied? The matter went for advance ruling. First advance ruling, at the first level, the advance ruling authority said it is a service. So you have to pay 18%. Appeal was filed against that. wherein an argument was taken saying, yes, there is no doubt there is a service, but the service is consumed to supply goods. The service doesn't go to the customer. It was a central excise concept per se. There is service, but service is used by me, own self-use, to produce a goods, and what is supplied as per the purchase order is a goods. Therefore, it should be treated as a goods. Appellate authority for advance ruling upheld it. Ruled in favor. It is reported in the website, but in the reporting there is a mistake. They say upheld. The advance authority is upheld in that table brief, but you go into the decision, it is clear that it is overruled. But I am just trying to say, so I am just telling, these are something conceptually between the authority, government itself, there is a difference. Lot of advance rulings are coming. Majority, we find that it is towards tilting the revenue side. There are few only towards the SSC. So if you are sure that you want to pay tax, go and ask. Because your customer is not paying, he says, give me a proof, go for advance ruling. They will say you have to pay. Then give it to the customer and you can collect and pay. Advance ruling is binding only between the person who is seeking advance ruling and the government. It cannot be used as a precedent by other person, except maybe in another advance ruling you can use it as a precedent, but not by another person in the normal proceedings. Even the department should not use it, but they use it because it's their own departmental office's order. Next, I talked about whether the transaction is that of a interstate supply or intrastate supply. An example is supply to SEZ within a state. The specific provision, no, everything is within the state, so it's intrastate. No, since SEZ fits in, it is a interstate supply. So, the points which I'm trying to make is, wherever our general understanding goes wrong, many of the places. So we cannot only depend on our logic alone. We need to understand the law as well. Generally, in any of these indirect tax matter, there is a transaction which is clearly either taxable or clearly non-taxable. But majority of the thing presently in a GST is something which is in a gray area, in between the two. Over a period of time, that volume gets distributed either this side or that side. So we need to be conscious about the fact that these three classification as to the transactions, which of them is falling in that sector, which of them is falling in this sector, and which of them in this middle, that is where we have to be very careful upon. Now, these transactions which recorded in the books of accounts, we would have audited, etc., fine, we have checked the invoice, everything. But there may be a subsequent events, subsequent transactions, which affects the value which is already done. Presently, this sales target incentive already sold. Later on, I'm giving a sales target incentive. There are divergent views going on. Circulars issued, circulars withdrawn. They clarified something. They say, no, this clarification may not be correct. They withdrew it. So what SSC has to do, what order has to do while certifying, we do not know. And also, if you see the methodology of accounting that in the financial records also, when we come to GST, no sir, we reduce that as a, we treat that as a sales, sorry, purchase discount. We'll reduce from the purchase value. Sir, but in your financial records, you have shown it as a income, other income. Why? Because it's deducted TDS, sir. So to claim TDS, I need to show it separately. For GST purpose, no, sir, no tax payable, because it is nothing but a purchase discount. So your own record sings two different songs. So try to harmonize what you disclose, because till service tax you are doing that. But in GST, things have changed. Now they are not deducting TDS. In service tax, they were deducting TDS for these incentives. Now GST, even the companies have decided not to deduct TDS and giving it as a discount. But in last year's format of our financial statements, these incentives were recorded, shown separately as other income. We continued the same practice even the GST law. When the GST auditor or GST audit comes, now we are trying to say, no, this is a purchase discount. So this is where the conflicts come in. We need to be clear on the way we record the transaction in the books of accounts, the way we disclose those transactions in our financial records. There should be harmonization between the financial records, the financial statements, GST disclosure, GST returns, GST tax treatment. So this is a major things which we need to be conscious about. Like this, if we go on taking each of the aspects, we may find many such issues coming up. So now I leave the floor open. I have a couple of slides later, but before that, I want you to ask any questions as to the audit connected with the supplies. The same old question. Yes, sir, please. Yes, sir.
So, hello. This cross-charge billing. Can I just bill at some nominal value to each branch and say that I have complied with? Because see, it is, anyways, the other branch can take the credit of it. So the related party here is eligible to take complete credit. So is it okay?
Yeah, I'll repeat the question because many would have not heard it. There's a branch, there's another branch or head office. The billing happens to the customer only from head office, irrespective of the fact the same supply would have happened from another branch or this branch. But there is no cross billing done, or cross billing done very nominal. Say, extreme example, taking 1 rupee for a 10 crore transaction. Is it okay? The reason being, this is taxable, that is also taxable. If I had charged 10 crore also, he would have taken a credit on 10 crore, he would have paid that particular amount over there. So that is the question which is being framed. It is not me, the rule itself provides to say, in case of this related party or through this distinct person, that is who stayed as a separate person, then whatever the invoice value mentioned shall be accepted, provided the other entity is eligible to take a full credit.
Now continuing with the...
Let me complete, I have not just completed. Okay. Now, this is what the law says. Law has provided no doubt, but can it be to such an extent of merely 1 rupee for a 10 crore? Is that provision intended to say, no, instead of 10 crore, 9 crore, 54 lakh, or 10 crore, 10 lakh, because you can't value it, it doesn't really make a difference. You have done that, so it should not be questioned, being in the normal question, unnecessary opening up assessments and this thing. So, is that the intention, or saying, no, you need not? essentially when there is a cash flow issues of a payment, there is a substantial credit sitting there. Here, if they are taking credit, you are going to lose a credit, that's a different thing. But I am telling, ideally, this should not be suggested, but if somebody has done this, you can protect them through this law.
It's not done, it's...
No, I'm just telling, the suggestion is, don't suggest for future. If something is done, you can always use this as a protection.
No, when we are doing the audit, like to assess it, to recommend, because they have not done it, so what should we do there? So we SSC will...
Zero value is also if you have raised an invoice. But if you have not at all raised an invoice, there may be a problem. So whether you are going to establish that an invoice was raised as and when the supply has happened, see, I'm interpreting the same rule, valuation rule. If a department officer says, okay, that says if you raise an invoice and in the invoice you put a value and that value is differing, we are not going to question. Here in this scenario, not at all raise any invoice.
So at the time of audit, we asked the SSC to just raise an invoice and keep it for the record. That is okay.
Off the record. Please, anything else, sir?
Impact of withdrawal of this 105, circular 105, I think it is withdrawn, no? So now many are questioning that about this issue of financial credit note. Is it still okay to issue?
Withdrawal doesn't mean right or wrong.
See, as I understand, it was only clarification in nature.
No, I'm not telling that. There can be a two argument. Why I withdraw?
Your views.
No, that's what I'm telling. Sir, if you observed me from the beginning till now, I have not given any of my views.
I understand. That's why I'm asking your views.
The reason because we among our friends itself, we do not agree on each other's views. My purpose of here is not to confuse you anymore. Already you are confused, but I am telling there are number of decisions under the erstwhile before the GST law. Going by that proposition, this discounts, etc., still I think now they have investigating decision of even the service tax also they have raised, they are coming and raising our notices. Essentially two things we were looking. Point number one, is there a relationship of the supplier and receiver between the company and the distributor or a dealer? Understanding is that I am a buyer and seller of a goods. I am not the service provider to the company. When there is no such contractual obligation on me to act as a supplier of a service, in a transaction or an agreement for a purchase, can a service provider can be deduced out of it and say you are a supplier of service? I personally feel that cannot be to such an extent. Especially if any incentive is linked to the purchases. But businesses are different, sir. You cannot generalize every discount and every incentive to be of one nature, because in some places they say, if you keep your showroom nice and clean, I'm going to give this much percentage extra. Now, does this have anything to do with the purchase? This is also given as an incentive. But they say, no sir, if I give it 6%, next time also you will demand 6%. So I made it 4% and given this 2% in this way, that's all. It is nothing that much the same. This is what they give an explanation. So, problem is your document speaks one thing, your transaction is something else, you record in your book something else. So you need to be careful about the documentation vis-a-vis the treatment in the books, which is getting streamlined day by day, because they are also facing the difficulties, things are there. But for the first year, 17-18, this challenge does exist, that incentives. I am of the view that incentives to the extent connected to your purchase of goods and subsequent sale of it, it is nothing but a part of your purchase transactions. And there, they have clearly said, if you are fulfilling a condition, credit note, if you are not fulfilling a condition, you can issue a financial credit note. To that extent, I take a benefit of it.
The impact on the recipient of this financial credit note? Impact on the recipient?
My understanding is there is no requirement of reversal of the proportionate credit. That's what you are asking, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Yes, sir. Please.
Whether it is a part of the supply or not, I think it is a reimbursement of interest what I am paying to the bank.
Does your document say it's a reimbursement of interest?
No, they are giving you as a cash discount.
No, correct. Cash discount is a cash discount.
Yes.
Why are you giving a one more nomenclature that it is an interest?
Yeah, because I am paying to the bank.
No, that is, that may be the reason why you may be giving.
That is my question, is whether it is a supply or not.
No, I'll answer that question, but the I was first addressing the answer you yourself gave.
No, I think that.
No, I'm telling, we have that habit generally to put across some reasoning to it, but please understand, your document should speak about anything what you talk about, and it should be not a far-fetched inference. It should be coming out directly through a direct documentation per se. Now, coming to the question of a cash discount, it is merely reduction in the consideration payable. It is not a consideration, I mean, it's not a separate supply. It is equal to that financial credit note concept which we explained. Otherwise, because it doesn't fulfill all the conditions of that required under the law, so you cannot issue a credit note with a reduction in the taxes. So thereby, it's again not a separate supply also. You need not give a tax impact. This comes outside the tax impact. This is what is my view on it.
Sir, other question is, client is the liquor sale, that is wine shop or the bar and restaurant they are running without food supplies. Whether the RCM is applicable, section 9 bracket 4, because it is not a supply. Wine sale is not a supply, as per the definition of supplies. Whether the whatever I consume, the services or the other goods, whether it's a supply or not. That is.
Sir, 9.4 is an independent provision. 9.4 is, there are two things, please understand. When you are saying 9.4, if a supply per se is non-taxable, supply, not my output, what I receive, which is subjected to reverse charge mechanism, if per se is a non-taxable, then you cannot bring in a RCM in to tax it. Because my reading of that 9.4, 9.4 is a supplemental to 9.1. It is not independent of 9.1. First of all, you need to fulfill a condition of 9.1. 9.2 is a supplemental to 9.1. 9.3 is a supplemental to 9.1. 9.4 is a supplemental to 9.1. So you cannot read it dehorse 9.1. So 9.1 is a primary thing which has to be fulfilled to get move forward. Without you fulfilling, it's like, you know, 9.2 and all is like a provisos to 9.1. This is how we can read it be. Now coming into your question, my liquor sales is not a supply, but registration. Am I required to take a registration once I am receiving any supplies? Compulsory registration, I am falling into it. But once I take a registration, I am supposed to take a discharge that particular liability on that particular thing. So thereby it will get covered. It's coming under 9.3 for freight and other things. 9.4 is only now limited to certain, I mean, construction sector per se, not to other sectors as of now. So need not worry on that. That initial period which was there, that again, the question which is there is whether whatever the exemption given, is it retrospective or prospective for that few months, whether it's payable, not payable. I think if I ask 10 people here, what you reported, sir? Sir, what is the time? Few of them may say, what is the time? Not at all aware. Some of them, no, sir, it's retrospective. Some of them, no, sir, we ask them to pay and take a credit. When did you ask that? Now, sir. Okay, no doubt. There's only one more show cause notice for a ineligible credit, separate show cause notice for that amount. So, I think I'm not, today we are in a very, very fluid state of affairs where there's no clarity and we need to face as it comes. And nobody can be faulted upon. It is the environment is what is, which is causing a problem. Next. Yes, sir. Okay, before your question, I answered it, but anyhow, the question which is being asked here is, for 17-18, the same example I take, there was a RCM liability. 9-4 only, URD purchases for that, whatever, the first 3 months. Now, whether the time limit to avail credit applies or not. The view which is taken to say that you can pay now, take credit, is for the reason because it says from the date of the invoice. In case of RCM, there is no invoice from a URD. URD doesn't raise an invoice. Invoice means a tax invoice because invoice is defined in the Act. So invoice means a tax invoice. So since no tax invoice is existing in this case, the question of time limit under 16.4 should not be applied. So now, but however, if you go to rules, etc., they say even in case of RCM, you are supposed to raise a self-invoice. So you raise a self-invoice today. From there, I get a time. So therefore, I am validly taking a credit. Now the question is whether it goes with the intention of the statute or not with the intention. No, sir, we are not going with the intentional, we are going with the words. But in some other cases when it comes, no, sir, we should not go with the words, we should go with the intention because otherwise it will defeat the purpose. So we change the stand. But for your information, many of them have got it done the same way. And wherever the amount is huge, they have said, we have considered it to be retrospective. So no worry. So I think in this case, for answer to you is, you can take a credit, but it, in my view, it would be subject to litigation. Okay. No, we are not taking a credit. We are taking credit in the current year for the current year input tax credit. We are not taking for the 17-18.
For 17-18, if there is a RCM liability, SS is not paid RCM, now can be forced to pay RCM and take credit?
That is what is a question. They pay today as a RCM, raise a self-invoice today, take that as an input tax credit of the current year because RCM will not be uploaded in 2A. So I take a credit in the current year. This is what was there. Now you are talking about 9 and 9C. No credits can be pushed in through 9 and 9C. Only DRC03.
In 9C, can we use words, ITC was allowed subject to verification by Goods and Services Department?
ITC, you should ask Banu. Banu has gone away.
Example, suppose it's 2A,
it is
eligible credit, non-eligible credit, we cannot verify to enter each and every transaction. We are allowed as per books of account.
Don't use allowed, sir. Huh? Don't say allowed, you are not allowing.
We consider to be allowed.
No, I am telling, it is verified based on that, it is eligible as per understanding.
Subject to verify Goods and Services Department.
No, subject to verification and all, you cannot say. No, I'm telling you are not allowing. That's a point which I was trying to say. You are only saying whether the value shown is correct, whether credit is eligible and claimed, your eligibility, you feel that it is not eligible. Assessing says that no, it's eligible. So there's a dispute. There you can put a say that our understanding, here again, three types of a disclosure, the same point. Though there is a doubt, the assessee has taken a credit on this. Leave it at that. Second, though there is a doubt, or assessee has taken a credit, but we feel there is some doubt about the eligibility of a credit. Leave it at that. Third, assessee has taken credit. In our view, it is not eligible. He should pay.
If we put that word, immediately, no lottery will come. Doubts words.
Now you should be clear whether you want to be safe or assessee want to be safe.
Both.
That's what the first one I say. Otherwise, you can say, assessee has taken a credit on these items. Leave it at that. You're disclosed. Why you're disclosed? Because I also have some doubts, so I put disclosed. You're not telling that doubt also, you don't want to use a word. You can say, assessee have taken a credit on these elements. In the initial, there you're not putting only one item. You're putting an item which is clearly eligible, which is also doubtful. Saying, since the initial days of it, there is no clarity, we are disclosing the assessee has taken a credit on the following items. You put all the 10 items. One of them is in between there, which is also doubtful. So you have done your job, assessee is also protected, you are also protected. Okay. Now you talked about 9, I'll complete and come back. 9 return is a return which I can tell that is a dummy. Because it doesn't affect any of the other, it doesn't affect your cash ledger, does not affect your credit ledger, doesn't create any additional liabilities straight away. It's merely an information for an authority if he wants to take a further proceedings. Otherwise, it's merely a dump of information which is going to the authorities. 9C, also a similar thing with somebody giving some chapa on it. Now, whether I can use a credit for paying any of these points which came up during the audit. Aggressive view, I am using out aggressive view. Before you file 9 or 9C, you generate DRC03 as a voluntary payment and pay that amount and file 9. You can put such a voluntary payment under 73 is fine. 74 is a evasion, etc., etc. 73 is a voluntary payment. Put a voluntary payment, utilize a credit, there is no bar. Now, you have filed a return. Later on when they come, see, there is a difference. Sir, before you came, I voluntarily paid. There is a provision in 73, voluntarily if you pay with interest, no further proceedings. So, this is one more way where you can use. Now, there is one more question, whether you can use a current date's credit for the past liability. Sir is saying no. Sir, you should have been a C&AG audit. There is no such concept per se. Though there is one thing in assessment, 42, 41(2) or something, there is a provision, self-assessment. But again, the linking goes in. There is again a possibility to take that argument. Now, for 17-18, somebody has to sign, and assessee is not ready to, not ready. He doesn't have that much money to pay, but he has a lot of credit, Tran-1 credit. This is one possibly, I am telling aggressive view. I am not telling, it is clear. But there is a certain aspects practically we can look at it at a relevant point in time. Right. Somebody was asking. Yes, sir.
In case of the government society,
Can you just repeat the last part?
Hello. Yeah. The grants received from the government by the government society and again giving it to the other implementing agencies, whether giving grants to the other implementing agencies will be considered as a supply or it is an exempted supply or a non-GST supply.
Okay.
First, supply, giving something for getting something.
Yeah.
Okay. We need to be very careful about the transactions where there's a government, there's an agency, and another private entities. Why I'm saying that is, this intermittent agencies, that whatever you call as a government agencies, many a times will be merely a nodal agency, nomenclated and indicated as nodal agency, which means they do not have an authority to do anything on their own. They are merely a custodian of the funds, custodian of the funds and administrating agency. Having said it, what does, because there will be an agreement between the implementing agency and the government, they being one of the third party as an implementing agency, a different treatment. No, government gives a grants without any specific project allocation, project based, as a general, this year, so many crores for your implementation. Now, out of that implementing, that government agency will go and identify a NGOs or other entities and allocate a funds for a project. Government to that government agency, first, is there a supply? If it is given as a lump sum amount without linkage to anything back, no supply, only a fund transfer. Now, assume that no, it is project specific. They say you implement this project, give this report, ensure that this is done. I am going to give this much fund to you for the government agency. There's a supply. Next question. Yes, sir, it's supply, whether it's exempted. That's what was your next question. There's an exemption in the notification number 12 of 2017, dated 28th June 2017. I think CL number 3 or as well as 4 or 3A rather. You see that there is a exemption for any services provided by any person to a government, local authority, governmental authority and government entity. All are different. Government entity is an entity which is set up by an act of the parliament or state legislature or incorporated by the government with 90% more of equity or control for any of the functions entrusted to it. No bar as to what function it should have. So if in the agency of your example, they may fit into the definition of government entity.
Yes.
Yeah. But the exemption entry says, provided the supply is in relation to any of the functions entrusted to municipality under Article 243W or Panchayat under Article 243G. So there you have to see the project, what project is being carried out. And if that project is in any of the area which is set out in either 11th schedule or a 12th schedule of the Constitution of India, then it will be exempted. Now, same thing goes to the next level as well. So this is what from the thing, from the government to thing also, this is an exemption. So you have to see one, the entity, Next, what is the nature of project which is being carried out? Again, if there is a, other than if it's a works contract, construction of a building and all comes, it becomes a works contract. In such a case, whether the material value is more than 25% or less than 25%. So all these things, if you examine, you can examine that it can be exempted. Clear? Thank you. Sorry? No, there is another entry. There is another entry, works contract where the material involved is less than 25%. Another one is a pure service. So both are there. So it may not be a supply is not covered. So any other questions? So shall I move on? So conceptual aspect of supplies, I think I have addressed. Now I am coming into the next part and more important part. Now we have understood, we have found. Now we have to prepare a report. While reporting, what all will come, how to address that? The first statement is known to everybody. Law being new, divergent views are possible. Sir, we know divergent. You tell us one view. That is what one of our friend also said. Sir, we know there is thing, but what is your view? So the same question which I need to ask as an auditor when you are signing, what is your view, sir? You should tell that. You need to freeze on a particular view. Depending upon your risk appetite. We'll sign this time, we'll see later what happens. No, we can't sign. No, later on something happens. So, depends on person to person. I am not saying what is right, what is wrong, but I'm telling all the possibilities are there. Same thing, for some client we are more stricter, some client we may be liberal. So, what is the stand? There are challenges in this on a particular issue. For one client, I have taken a particular stand and signed. On the same issue for other client, I am taking a different view. Is it permissible? Sir says, yes, it can be done. Here, that's the reason why I told in the beginning, I am not an assessing officer. They cannot say you have done a discrimination between the two assessees. We are only confirming the stand taken by a assessee with a documentation relevant to them. So, as far as possible, you please harmonize the situation, because later on there may not be any question on that. But nevertheless, you can, in an extreme thing with a proper reasoning, you can take a differing view as well. As I said, if you are taking a particular stand, have a proper documentation. If it requires an independent legal opinion, expert opinion, please take it and say, as per the opinion taken by the entity, this amendment is retrospective and therefore there is no liability for the period prior to so and so, is in your working papers. Report your silent. See, I had already taken, and this is what the basis on me not reporting it. So please be sure about what stand you have taken. You please prepare your documentation for whatever the audit you have done appropriately. Have a supporting documents for the stands taken. When there's a short turnover or a difference in turnover, whatever is there, that you report, you say this is the amount which is to be paid or short declared. Auditee will say, okay sir, I'll pay, I don't want headache, I'll pay. Some of them say, no sir, no chance. No, it is clearly payable, law is clear. No, sir, I don't have money. No, he doesn't say his request. He's only saying, I don't have money, I will not pay. So, what you should be doing, I have no answer to it, where you have clearly concluded, you are clear, the goods applicable rate of tax is a particular rate of tax, clearly their schedule is there, there is no confusion, but still the SSE has charged a lower rate of tax. If he has not at all charged, it's a different thing, but he has charged lower rate of tax. Now, you have to report as a recommendation saying that this one. Then the SSE's thing department may come. Maybe you will not get the next year audit for that SSE. Methods of disclosure. In the course of my deliberation, I did mention about this. Some things you give it as a notes. Some things you may give it as a comments, little serious than a notes. Observations, the reporting with recommendation. And again, you know, it may be with quantification, without quantification. If you are doing a quantification, how to quantify, whether you are in a position to quantify. If you are reporting, it should be quantified. You cannot report without quantification. Then it should come as an observation or a disclaimer. Observation with a disclaimer. Observation with a partial disclaimer. So all this permutation combination can be there depending upon each individual audit which you are facing. Sorry? Subject to following. There, put a heading, notes, comments, this thing. Put a separate heading. So, in order to not get attracted to your points, put many more points also, which is clearer. Like, you know, you put the notes to accounts, right? Revenue is recognized on this basis, these things. In between, there's also one point where you have a problem also. So it is a part of the same reporting. If somebody wants to really go deeper and read, let them read it. So as a part of a comment, as a part of a notes, as a part of a reporting observation, it's all possible. Next, the way you write these wordings is also critical. You are told, but you are not told. You know, always that the mythological story, Ashwatthamaha Atha Kunjaraha. So, the similar thing. You see, I have told or not? I have told. And you can't blame me. So, and the language you use is also critical. Like, you know, allow. You are not an authority to allow anything. You are merely verifying. You have verified, found. So, you should open the dictionary. For the same word, what is the other alternative words which are there, which not commonly used, so that if the person wants to read, you need to open the dictionary so that he can't understand and leave it at there. So I'm telling these are some practical things which would be relevant while actually drafting that. I've added two slides on audit environment related thing, because today you cannot do an audit which we were doing earlier, because you ask a trial balance, they give one sheet which do not appear like a trial balance what we were seeing earlier. Total doesn't match. No, sir, you see this, you add this, you minus this, you this, then it tallies. No, how do you say this is, this accounting code is there, no, this code, ledger code. You see this, this starting this number is this. No, I'm telling, as an auditor, we are still used to get a printout. How much you are sure that what printout given to you is the same what is recorded in the books of accounts?
In fact, it was quite some time back when in one of the hotel industry or some retail industry, they said, sir, generate your sales register for the day. Okay, sir. Just give me a minute, sir. He did something, generated. He gave one report. Hey, what man, so much less sales. Oh, sorry, sir, 1 minute, wait. Did something, generated another sales report. As what did he do? No, sir, we have an option. You need to key in the percentage of the sales to be disclosed. Whatever he tells and gives you the thing, it is there somewhere. Now, at the end of the day, he will decide how much percentage of sales to be disclosed. So it will omit in between, do whatever the exercise they have given, whatever the logic behind, they will generate a sales report and give it. So that is put into a file and accounted. I'm just telling, if I just sample thing, at least we need to know these basic things. What is the technology deployed by the SSE? What is the software he is using? Whether it has a possibility to report everything? How it works? Whether there's any checks and balances for something to correct it? We have our own techniques of looking at a gross level. If this is a sales, this should be purchases. If there's a sales this much, there should be something here. If it's missing, we need to know, do the verification using our own techniques to ascertain whether the systems are working correctly. Whether you say, what is the system you're adopting? See, sir, this is what we have done, this is what you have done, this is done. Okay. They give you one master, whatever the ledger master with the tax statement sheet. Now the question is, whether this master sheet which you are given, was it operating throughout the period? Or it is made in between, where your audit period is for the entire period. But if it is done from when it is done, now the GST rates have been changing in between. What was the period, date on which the cutoff date where the things got changed? Whether they changed on that particular day? What was the effect of the transitional transactions which were supposed to have been taken? So I think this is what something which we need to look into, going into the masters of that particular thing, not merely looking into the voucher, I mean ledger printout or voucher printout per se. At the same time, system configuration, mapping, external confirmation, error handling procedure. Now this government, that's why they have come with 2A, reconciliation, if you don't, they don't upload beyond the 10%, you will not get a credit, etc. So, I think with this, I can close my session. Any questions, you can either ask or you can also send a mail to this. Thank you one and all.
I request members to wait for 2 minutes to conclude the session. Give me a big round of applause for an excellent session. Thank you, sir. I thank on behalf of Bangalore branch of ICA. May I request CA Gajendra Budala to present a memento to the speaker as a token of gratitude and respect. Thank you, sir. Thank you all. We'll break for lunch. We'll reassemble by 2:30 for third technical session. Thank you.